Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. In our last class of Seerah, through the tafseer of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we looked at the sixth set of verses to come to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the circumstances on the context in which those verses were revealed. And those set of verses were the set of verses from Surah Al-Masad. And this Surah Al-Masad, with it began a da'wah al-jahriyah, the open propagation of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Surah Al-Masad marked the beginning of a da'wah al-jahriyah. And we mentioned last week the sabab al-nuzul, the reason Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed these verses from Surah Al-Masad. And that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَأَنذِرْ عَشِيرَتِكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ, to warn your nearest kinsmen. After this order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam صَعِدَ عَلَى الصَّفَى, he climbed upon Mount As-Safa, فَجَعَلَ يُنَادِي, and he began to call, يَا صَبَحَا يَا صَبَحَا, to alert the Quraysh. And after alerting them, they all gathered. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to them, if I was to warn you of an invading army that's about to come from that valley, and they could all see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so they could see behind him, there was no army. He said, if I was to warn you there's an invading army coming from these valleys, would you believe me? The Quraysh, they all said with consensus, na'am ma jarabna alayka al-kadhib, we all believe you because we've never known you to lie. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to them, inni, I am a warner to you, bayna yaday adhabin shadeed, before a painful punishment. At this point, the whole of the Quraysh, they kept quiet. Because another Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is truthful, except for one of the Quraysh. Well, after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spoke, he spoke immediately. And this was Abu Lahab. He said, Ali hadha jama'tana, do you mean that you've gathered us together just for this? Tabban lak, tabban lak, يعني, may destruction, loss be your lot. So here he was making dua against the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, say tabban lak. And as soon as he said this, the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala came down in defense of his Prophet. The saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ba'da a'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim, bismillahir rahmanir rahim, tabbat yada abi lahabin wa tabba ma aghna anhu maluhu wa ma kasab. So after this, the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was revealed concerning Abu Lahab. First and foremost, who is Abu Lahab? Abu Lahab, as we mentioned last week, is from the nine uncles of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from his father's side. Because the grandfather of the Prophet, if you go back to Seerah, the beginning of Seerah, the grandfather of the Prophet, Abdul Muttalib, had 10 children. But before having these 10 children, he made a vow to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that if Allah blesses him with 10 children, he will slaughter one of them as a sacrifice in appreciation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the 10th child came. And after the 10th child came, he had to do a Qur'an, to draw a lot. Which one of his 10 sons is going to sacrifice? And the lot he fell upon who? Abdullah, the father of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So now he had to slaughter him. So the Quraysh went to him and said, look, anta sayyiduna, you're from the nobles of us, our leaders. If you do this, it becomes a sunnah, a thing which all of us will have to do. So they went to a kahin, a fortune teller, to get some kind of religious verdict. What can we do to come out of this? Because he made a vow to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they say, you have to slaughter 100 camels to ransom your son. So he slaughtered 100 camels. So the sons of Abdul Muttalib were 10. However, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam became a prophet, only 4 were alive. And these 4 were from his uncles. And those 4 were Abu Talib, Al-Abbas, Hamza, and what else? Abu Lahab. And they took 4 different paths. The first path of those who believed in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from his uncles. And that was who? Hamza and Al-Abbas. These 2, they believed in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The second track was those who did not believe in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or he who did not believe in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but yet he defended the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this was who? Abu Talib. And the last category is he who disbelieved in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, became an enemy to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This was who? Abu Lahab. But enemy to Abu Lahab was not just an internal enmity. It was a person that would show his enmity to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam publicly. And Abu Lahab, in showing this enmity to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam publicly, he remained consistent upon that. that it will show it publicly. And that's why in the hadith of Rabi'a al-Abbad radiallahu anhu, he said in his days of Jahiliyyah, he came to Mecca. فَإِذَا بِرَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ قَدْ جَمَعَ النَّاسِ. And he saw that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, this is the beginning of da'wah, it gathered the people. جَمَعَ النَّاسِ يَدْعُوهِمْ إِلَى اللَّهِ. It gathered the people calling them to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم would go to the marketplaces by himself in the beginning of da'wah, saying to the people, قُولُوا لَا إِلَى إِلَى اللَّهِ تُفْلِحُوا. Say, لَا إِلَهَ إِلَى اللَّهِ, you'll be successful. And the people begin to listen to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Rabi'a ibn al-Abbad, he said, فَإِذَا خَلْفَهُ. But all of a sudden, there'll be behind him, رَجُلٌ وَضِيءُ الْوَجْهِ. A man that had a radiant and a bright face. And this man behind the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam will walk behind him everywhere and say to, لَا تُصَدِّقُوا. Don't believe him. أَنَا عَمُّهُ وَإِبْنُ أَخِي. I'm his uncle, he's the son of my brother. إِنَّهُ كَذَّاب. He's a liar. Subhanallah. So Abu Lahab, his enmity was open, and he'd do anything to block the da'wah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So this surah was revealed concerning Abu Lahab. So in reply to what he said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, تَبَّنْ لَكْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, تَبَّتْ يَدَا. تَبَّتْ, it means هَلَكَتْ وَخَسِرَتْ. That destroyed and in loss are the hands of Abu Lahab. And tabba yada, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala referred to the hand of Abu Lahab. Why? Because most deeds, most action is done with the what? The hand. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, ظَهَرُ الْفَسَادُ فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحَرِ. Corruption has appeared on the face on the earth. Why? بِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِ النَّاسِ. Because of what the hands of people, they have earned. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he did not refer to Abu Lahab, but the hands of who? Abu Lahab. Because his deeds, like most of us, is true the what? It's true the hand that made the hands of Abu Lahab be in loss. May the hands of Abu Lahab be in destruction. But it doesn't mean just his hands, it means the whole of Abu Lahab. Because one of the signs of the Qur'an is, or one of the signs of the Arabic language is balagha. Balagha. If you study the Arabic language, balagha. Al-Balagha has many different branches. One of it is tashbih, compare two things. So ka, to compare two things. One of the signs of Balagha, likewise, is dhikrul ba'd ma'a iradatil kull. To mention a part of something even though you mean the whole thing. And what is an example of this? An example of this is Surah Al-Mujadala, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالَّذِينَ يُظَاهِرُونَ مِن نِسَائِهِمْ. And those who do, or those who say to their wives, you're like the back of my mother to me. If they want to divorce their wife, say like you're the back of my mother. Meaning you're not halal for me. You are like, and it's called zihar. Allah Ta'ala said, those who do this, ثُمَّ يَعُودُونَ لِمَا قَالُوا. And they go back to what they said. If they want to go back to their wives, فَتَحْرِيرُ رَقَبًا مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَتَمَاسَّ. They have to free a slave before they could go back to their wives. But here Allah Ta'ala said they have to free what? Raqaba, a neck. So Allah Ta'ala intends the whole, but he mentions a part of it. Jayid? So from the sciences of the Arabic language, that they'll mention a part of something, but they mean the whole of that. So when he says the hand of Abu Lahab, it means the whole of what? Abu Lahab. It means the whole of what? Abu Lahab. So Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, if we notice here as well, he mentioned him specifically. And the manhaj of the Qur'an, when it comes to the enemies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions their story without mentioning their what? Their name. But here Allah mentioned specifically Abu Lahab. So when Allah ta'ala talk about his enemies, such as Nimrud, Allah ta'ala says, أَلَمْ تَرَ إِلَّا الَّذِي حَاجَّ إِبْرَاهِيمَ فِي رَبِّي. Have you not seen the one who debated and argued with Ibrahim concerning his Lord? When he said, Ana uhyi wa umit. When Ibrahim said, my Lord gives life and give death. He said, I give life and give death. But his name is not mentioned here. But as for Abu Lahab, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned his name specifically to show the level of his enmity to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when we say Allah mentioned his name, no, but Allah mentioned him specifically. Because when we did the beginning of the seerah, we said there's three ways that Arabs refer to somebody. And what are those three ways, Ya Abdurrahim? Barakallahu feek. By his name? Barakallahu feek. By his kunya? And what's the third one? We said ismun wa kunyatun. Ism is name, kunya. And what else? Laqab, a nickname. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions what of Abu Lahab? His what? His kunya. Or his nickname. We say kunya, it's a kunya. Allah ta'ala mentions his kunya. And we find the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam likewise that ism, a name, a kunya, and a laqab. And many laqab, many titles or nicknames. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned his kunya. And a person's kunya, meaning Abu, the father of something, is usually referring to what? Your firstborn child. And the Arab usually use it for firstborn male. So it refers to your firstborn male. So for example, I am Abu. If I was to follow the Arabs all the way through, I'll not be Abu Hanifa. In that I'll be Abu Abdirrahman. Because Hanifa is a girl. Jayid? So they use it to refer to your firstborn son or firstborn daughter, but in most cases, firstborn son. And this kunya could also be used to something you're known for, you're accustomed to. So for example, if somebody knows you for a particular thing, they call you Abu that particular thing. So for example, I remember when I lived in Saudiya, in Saudi Arabia, we used to go to a particular park by the masjid. And this boy was, you know, like children and their toys, they're very territorial. But this boy was not territorial in his house, it was territorial in his park, in that park. There was a particular swing, nobody could touch that swing. Nobody. And my poor daughters, mashallah ta'ala, with her three brothers, we should be defending her, they went to this park. And my daughter had no clue of this, the mother was playing to her away. So my daughter's there swinging. Before she knew, this boy set upon her. From that day, we knew this boy as Abu Swing. And subhanAllah, I said it for 3 years. It was years, 3 years later, it dawned upon us. We don't even know his name. Do you remember his name? His name was actually Saeed, but everyone knew him as Abu Swing because of his closeness to that thing. So sometimes a person's kunya could overtake their real name. So for example, if I was to ask you now, who is Luqman? Nu'man al-Thabit, from the greatest ulama. Nu'man al-Thabit. I'll give you a clue. Nu'man al-Thabit. Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah ta'ala. But all know him as what? Abu Hanifa. If I also ask you, Salman, who is Abdurrahman al-Sakhar? Anyway. MashaAllah. Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu. His brother's getting more, mashaAllah. If I also ask you, Akhil Kareem, Abdullah ibn Abdul Asad. Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. If I also ask you, Ya al-Yamini Muhammad, Abdullah ibn Abi Quhafa. Ya, my son is always asking difficult questions. طيب, I won't ask you today. Ya Shaykhana, Abdullah ibn Abi Quhafa. Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. But we know them by their what? By their kunya. So sometimes your kunya could overtake you, that people just know you by your kunya. Secondly, we have ism, like some sahaba, like Umar. We all know Umar as Umar. But what is the kunya of Umar, radiallahu anhu? Abu Hafs. Did he have a daughter called Hafs? Hafs in Arabic is a lion. No son called Hafs. He had a daughter called Hafsa, but he was known as the father of the lion. So it could be a title for something you know for Abu Huraira. Radiallahu anhu was known for what? His love of kittens. So it's called Abu Huraira. So it's either due to having a son or something you're known for. And then you have ism, Umar. You have laqab. Laqab such as Al-Faruq. This was the title of Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So Abu Lahab, this was his what? His kunya. Abu Lahab was his kunya. But what is preferred? Na'am.
If it's the other way around, so it's like ibn, so is that kunya as well?
Yeah, it could be that. Ibn also could be not a kunya, but rather a nickname, a laqab. Na'am, a laqab. It'd be a nickname.
Abu.
Could also be. So, for example, a kunya, Abdullah. Whose kunya is this from the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Aisha radiallahu anha. Even though she didn't have a child, she called Abdullah. Likewise, it could be due to something someone's known for. So, if you call Kalam, Kathir. Don't do that though. So, this is his kunya. But what is preferred to call a person by? We see why this is important. Is it preferred to call him by his name, his kunya? The ulama, some ulama say it's preferable and better to call a person by his name. Why? All the anbiya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Qur'an, when Allah ta'ala addresses them, he addresses them how? With their names. And no prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned the Qur'an by his kunya. The only person that's mentioned the whole Qur'an by his kunya is who? Abu Lahab. So therefore, they say it's better to call a person by his name. However, this thing on what is apparent seems okay. But as we know, the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is what makes the Qur'an more clearer. And if you go back to the sunnah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, did he have a kunya? Naam, he had a kunya. The Sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they had kunya, Abu Darda, Abu Dhar. So therefore, we cannot say it's more preferable to call a person by his name, but what we say, the most preferred thing is what a person prefers to be called by. So for example, Abu Hanifa here, culturally speaking, he will find it disrespectful if my son was to just call him by his name. In fact, I don't even know his name. So culturally speaking, you have to say Abu Hanifa. He will prefer that. So what is better is what somebody prefers to be called by. So here Allah Ta'ala mentioned Abu Lahab by his name. Why is he called Abu Lahab? If you go back to the hadith of Rabi'ah ibn Abbad, he said, Abu Lahab kana wadi al-waj. He had a bright and radiant face. In other words, he was handsome. Jayyid? So calling him Abu Lahab here, in this context where he should be humiliated and debased, why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala call him Abu Lahab? The ulama, they say Allah ta'ala called him Abu Lahab and mentioned by this for three reasons. His real name is Munshirki. His real name was the name of Shirk. His real name was Abdul Uzza, one of the biggest idols of Quraysh. So Allah ta'ala want to call him by this name as an acknowledgement of Uzza. Secondly, his kunya was more known to people than his what? His name. So Abdul Uzza, it could be anybody, but when Allah Ta'ala says Abu Lahab, he knows it's directly for who? For him. And that's when these verses came down. Immediately, his wife, we're going to speak about later on, she went and she looked for the biggest rock she could find to go and hit the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was with Abu Bakr As-Siddiq radiallahu anhu at the Kaaba. And Abu Bakr spotted it. He said, Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, Jameel, this is her kunya, is coming towards you. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, don't worry, she's not going to see me. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put a veil between her and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now when she approached, she said to Abu Bakr, Aina sahibuka? Where's your friend? Abu Bakr was shocked. He said, Aina sahibuka? Hajani. Your friend Hajani, he has done al-hijah. Hijah is one form of poetry that the Arabs used to practice, which is if you want to disrespect someone, diss somebody, for lack of a better term, slang, diss somebody, we just give him those hijah, that poetry. She said, Hajani, he's done this poetry to insult me. Then Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he said to her, he's not a Shia'i, he's not a poet, he's not a poet. But she didn't accept it. And she said, now she brought up her own hijah. And hijah is something you do to hit somebody. She said, Ala kulli hal, when you see him, فَأَخْبِرُهُ مُذَمَّمًا مُذَمَّمًا عَصَيْنَا وَدِينَهُ قَلَيْنَا وَأَمْرُهُ عَصَيْنَا. Immediately. And this is one of the things that Arabs had, this oratory thing that immediately they could make. So look how that bad speech, terrible speech, it rhymed. مُذَمَّمًا عَصَيْنَا دِينَهُ قَلَيْنَا وَأَمْرُهُ أَبَيْنَا. Tell Mudhammam. Who's Mudhammam? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But Mudhammam is the opposite of Muhammad, the one that deserves praise, but here Mudhammam, the one that deserves blame. Tell Mudhammam that we disobeyed him. دِينَهُ قَلَيْنَا. We'll never follow his deen. وَأَمْرُهُ أَبَيْنَا. And as for his orders, we rejected them. This was Jameel. So he knew Abu Lahab, this is immediate about him. Thirdly, they say, the reason Allah Ta'ala called Abu Lahab, that sometimes a person, lahu nasib min ismihi, his name actually influences him. So we know Abu Lahab, sayasla naran dhata lahab. Because lahab literally means flame. He's going to enter a fire of flames. And this happened, like once a Sahabi came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this Sahabi was the grandfather of the great scholar Sa'id ibn Musayyib. Sa'id ibn Musayyib said, my grandfather met the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet asked, Masmuka, what is your name? He said, Hazan, my name is Hassan, Hazan, meaning sadness and roughness. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, La, bal anta sahad, but you're sahad. He said, La ughayyir ismi, I'm not going to change my name. Sa'id ibn Musayyib, he said, from all his offspring, that sadness or that roughness remained of all of them. So a person's name influences them. That's why you name your children the best of names. Like one of the daughters of Umar radiallahu anhu was called Asiyah, meaning the disobedient one. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him to name her Jamila. So Tabbat yada Abi Lahab. And then Allah Ta'ala says, wa tab. The ulama, they say this is from the miracle of the Quran. That we said the first ayah was talking about the first part of Abu Lahab, his hands. That's what Allah Ta'ala said, Tabbat. Because in Arabic, anything that comes in pair in the body is what? Feminine. So Allah Ta'ala said, Tabbat with a ta. Because anything which is feminine verb will come with a ta. For example, for a man, akala, he ate. For a woman, akalat. For a man, dhahaba, he went. For a woman, dhahabat. So in the end of the ayah, what does Allah Ta'ala say? Tabbat or tab? Tab. Why? Because it's referring to the whole of Abu Lahab. To make it ta'keed, the whole of Abu Lahab is in destruction, is in loss. Secondly, this part of the ayah, they said, mean dalalatin nubuwa, is a proof of the prophethood of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because the first part is dua against him, and the second part is what? Khabar. News and information related to state. That tabba qad waqa'a is already destroyed. Meaning Abu Lahab will never become a Muslim. Abu Lahab could have pretended, said, I'm a Muslim. And with that argument, people would have disbelieved in the Quran because Allah Ta'ala tabba is already happened. He will never become a Muslim. This was from dalalatin nubuwa, the proof of the prophethood of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, ma, another thing in Arabic, ma. Ma in Arabic means, it's a letter that's used for istifham, interrogating, or a nafi, to negate. So for example, if I want to know what's your name, I say, masmuka, what? So ma means what? Or ma to read, what do you want? Or it could be used to negate. Like in the beginning of the Seerah, we said the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to Jibreel, ma ana biqari, I don't know how to read. So the meaning of this ayah could either be, ma aghna anhu maluhu, what did this wealth benefit him? A rhetorical question. Or it could be, ma aghna anhu, his wealth did not benefit him in anything whatsoever. But both are correct, negation and rhetorical question. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wa ma kasab, and that which is earned. The ulama, they say, ma kasab here refers to the children of Abu Lahab. Based on the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in which he said that atyabu, the best thing that a man could eat, atyabu ma akala rajul min kasbihi, the best thing you could eat is from your earnings. وَأَطْيَبُ كَسْبِهِ وَلَدُهُ, and the best of his earnings is his son. Now based on this, the ulama, they say that a father could take from his wealth of his children without their permission. Because that son is his what? His kasab, is his earning. So they say this refers to the children of Abu Lahab, that they will not benefit him in anything. Because Abu Lahab, he used to say, إِنْ كَانَ إِبْنَ أَخِي هَذَا صَادِقًا, just in case this nephew of mine is truthful, لَأَفْدِيَنَّ يَوْمَ قِيَامَ بِإِبْنِ وَمَالِ, I'll ransom myself from the punishment of Allah with my sons and my wealth. The level of arrogance. And we know, nobody will be able to ransom themselves from anybody or anybody will help anybody except if the father has iman. The son may be able to benefit him. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, إِذَا مَاتَ ابْنَ آدَمْ إِنْ قَطَعَ عَمَلُهُ إِلَّا مِنْ إِحْدَى الثَّلَاثِ, when you die, everything is cut off, except for three things. صَدَقَةٌ جَارِيَةٌ, a charity you gave which is continuous. Build a well. I advise everybody to do that. Build a well. Knowledge that people benefit by. Maybe you left some books behind, you distributed Qur'an, audio lectures, or waladun salih yad'u lah, a righteous child that makes dua for him. Rabbi rahamhuma kama rabbayani saghira. And it's a point for all of us that for those of us, our parents are no longer here, we should constantly make dua for our parents. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, a person will come yawm al-qiyamah, and when it comes yawm al-qiyamah, he will see his deeds yawm al-qiyamah. And when he sees his deed, yawm al-qiyamah, that is so much, or rufi'a darajatuhu, his levels will be raised. He said, Ya Rabbi, anna li hada. Oh my Lord, where did I get this from? He said, Allah Ta'ala will say, min istighfar ibnika or waladika. Due to your sons seeking forgiveness for you, your levels will be raised. From the sons' forgiveness. So even if our parents are alive, we should constantly seek the forgiveness of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala for them. And it shows blood relation doesn't benefit in anything. This was the uncle of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Even if that relationship was to be a relationship of father and son, like Nuh Alayhi Salam, in the dunya and akhirah, him being the father of his son didn't benefit. That's why he said to Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala when he says that, Rabbi, inna ibni min ahli, my son is from my family. Wa inna wa'daka al-haq, and your promise is true, that you'll not destroy my family. Allah Ta'ala says to him, innahu laysa min ahlik, he's not from your family. Innahu amalun ghayru salih, is not a righteous action. He's not from your family. That's why when it comes to Ahlul Bayt, the family of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Abu Lahab, is it considered to be from them? No. Only the believers from amongst them. And likewise, nobody's son could benefit them if the father's a kafir, like Ibrahim alayhi salam. Or uncle in this case. And even if that uncle was to be most beloved of your uncles, like in this case, in the case of Abu Talib, who defended the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he brought up and nurtured the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. The most he could do for him is to ask Allah Ta'ala to give him the lightest punishment in the hellfire. And the lightest punishment in the hellfire, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, يُلْبَسُ نَعْلَيْنِ مِنْ نَارِ يَغْلِي مِنْهُمَا دِمَاغُهُ. It will be given shoes made of fire to wear. And his shoes made of fire to wear that his brain will boil from them. Subhanallah. And the furthest thing from the head is what? The feet. So if his brain is boiling from the heat of those shoes, what about the rest of his body? And this is the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that's why they say, "Man batta bihi amaluhu lam yusri'uhu nasabuhu." Whatever person is delayed in doing good deeds, his deeds hold him back, his lineage will do nothing for him. So you have some people that believe in this Sharif dome or Sharif dome kind of thing, that I'm a Sharif, I'm a Sharif. It's your actions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So ma aghna anhu maluhu wa ma kasab. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, سَيَصْلَى نَارًا ذَاتَ لَهَبٍ. He's going to enter a fire made of flames. وَمْرَأَتُهُ, and his wife. His wife, her name was Ummu Jameel. حَمَّلَتَ الْحَطَبِ. She'll be carrying wood on her head. Wood for burning on her head. In the hellfire, that'll be a had. Ummu Jameel was a person that fought against the da'wah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Like her husband, with no excuse. Because Abu Lahab, he could have become a Muslim. There's people of the same noble position as him, they became Muslim. Same age, they became Muslim. Closeness of Prophet became Muslim. Ummu Jameel was a sister to who? Was a sister to Abu Sufyan. And her real name was Arwa. She harmed him night and day. It was said about Ummu Jameel, she used to carry wood on her head. That this wood on her head will have thorns, and she go and throw these thorns in the path of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at the darkest part of the day. And when was the darkest part of the day? Fajr. Because the Fajr of the Sahaba, they couldn't see the person next to them. They would pray in the earliest hour. So she go there and throw thorns at Fajr. And if this was not enough, the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, مَا وَدَّعَكَ رَبُّكَ وَمَا قَلَى. Your Lord has not abandoned you or left you alone. Was sent down because of Ummu Jameel. Why? She would not only do this in the daytime, she used to follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at night. And most likely, what was the action of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at night? What would he do at night? Pray and read the Quran. So Ummu Jameel, she always knew that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prayed at night. And we said always, ala sabil ghalib, majority of the time. Like somebody that prays in Jama'ah, he's always in the masjid. But it doesn't mean he's there every single time. So in two or three incidents, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he missed Qiyamul Layl. And she even knew that. because she used to follow him to that extent. She said to him, "Ara anna shaytanaka qad qalaq." I've not seen you read the Quran for 2-3 nights. This means your shaytan has left you alone. A'udhu billah. Your shaytan qalaq. That's what Allah Ta'ala revealed the ayah. Ma wadda'aka rabbuka wa ma qala. This was Ummu Jameel. So it's very harmful to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. حملت الحطب في جيدها حبل من مسد. So she's called, or she carried this flame for three reasons. The harm she caused the Prophet sallam. Also an-namima, she used to spread tales. And في جيدها حبل. She have a chain of حبل or حبل من مسد, from fiber, palm fiber. They said the reason for this, that Ummu Jameel, she had a very expensive necklace, gold. And she took this gold, she sold it, and whatever she earned from that gold, she spent it in harming the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the da'wah of Islam. And people look at the surah, the end of the surah, fi jidi hablum min masad. How harsh it is. That subhanallah, that if you look at the da'wah of Musa alayhi salam, the worst of transgressors, Fir'aun, Allah Ta'ala told him to say to him, qawlan layyina, to say to him a soft word. And generally the da'wah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was soft. So why now did we have this? They said you have to understand every single context. Some context calls for harshness, but and some context call for what? For softness. So this particular context, it called for harshness. But generally speaking, in da'wah, we shouldn't insult or abuse people. Because when you insult or abuse people, you're causing yourself to be insulted. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Inna rajul la yasubbu abahu wa huwa la yadri." A person insults his own father, he doesn't know. They say, how can you insult your own father by insulting the father of somebody else? He's going to insult your father. Likewise, in giving da'wah, we don't go out there, because some people use this as a proof, wrongly, that they go out, they say, look, Al-Lahab was insulted. So wherever the president of my country is, I'm going to insult them. I'm going to blast them, speak about them in this lab. Generally, the da'wah is da'wah of softness, lean, but in certain contexts, when it comes for harshness called for, we could use harshness. Next week, inshallah ta'ala, we'll be continuing with the open propagation, which we'll be doing for the next 4 weeks. And we'll be looking at some of the i'rad, some of the issues the mushrikeen had in the opening of the da'wah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Subhanakallah wa bihamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka.